Thank you very much for inviting me to this program. Every talk has a theme, and today the talk that I am going to give is all about doing wonders in medical devices with paper, pencil and eraser. There is a title of this talk, but the broad motivation is how to convert education and research from passion to mission, and I will explain how that all happens. So paper, pencil, eraser, these are very common things in our day-to-day lives. In my young days in school, I have always been fascinated to get a very nice new notebook which has nice pages, a very good pencil and a very nice eraser. That eraser later on turned out to be an erasing ink. And what I would like to tell you is that from these devices which we, or these gadgets which we used to enjoy as kids in our younger days, in those days not much advent of smartphones and all these devices were there, how we have converted these into useful products. So I will talk about a perspective which is very challenging. Imagine that there is a person sitting in the village or staying in the village and having to do some medical test. So the medical tests that need to be done for such people are very challenging. These people, they have to be brought from their own home to a primary healthcare center. Then in the primary healthcare center, some blood, urine, saliva, whatever, some sample is taken. That sample is brought to the big diagnostic lab. The tests are done, and it takes time, it takes money, and more than that, the patient can lose his or her one day of wage, and it is very challenging actually to travel that distance to do all these tests. So the paradigm shift is, instead of bringing the patient to the hospital, can you make a small handheld device and bring that to the patient? So before telling you how paper and pencil and eraser leads to that device, I would like to demonstrate a small product, very quickly simulate a process where from your fingertip one drop of blood is taken. I am not going to take blood from anybody, don't worry about it. Imagine it is taken, that blood is loaded in a piece of paper which is already preloaded with a chemical, and just by using a click of a smartphone it will give you some parameters, say glucose level in the blood. So what I have with me is a simple box. It contains nothing. It is just a box, and the idea of this box is to just hold the smartphone so that in a stable position it can take an image. I have a small piece of paper which you can see here. In this small piece of paper there is a location where the chemical has already been put, and what I will do is I will just put a sugar solution. So instead of sucking your blood, this is the alternative that I thought. You have all invited me, I should not suck your blood to make it a mess. So it will take a bit of a time to active, but you know, because the talk time is less, so I will just simulate the process instead of waiting for it. So what I am doing is, it's like reading a credit card. So this paper device I am going to insert here.
Sorry.
So then I am going to put the smartphone on this device. Smartphone, nothing special. See that it tells the glucose level 159 milligram per deciliter. I hope you could see it, but let me just show it here. So this is a very simple way in which, instead of putting the glucose solution, you put one drop of blood. Just within 1 minute you get the result. This is not a standard glucometer, and I will tell you what is the difference here. So coming back to the story of a paper, so how paper, pencil, eraser, all these can make this device. So paper is a very complex medium, and fluid flow in a paper is a very challenging thing to study. It's as complex and deep a science as you can imagine. Now, if you want to do a blood test on a piece of paper, what you have to do is something like this. I mean, you can see that if you look into the paper channel, which is made in a paper, the blood is loaded at one point, at one side, and the blood will move from its location to another location where there is a chemical, and the blood will react with the chemical. Why do you require the blood to move like that? The reason is that the blood can in principle move to different sites, and when it moves to different sites, it can do different diagnostic tests at different locations. If you allow the blood to move around the paper, it will just spread diffusively, and that you do not want. So you want to make barriers. Making barriers in blood, making blood barriers in paper is typically a costly proposition. What we have done is a very simple exercise. Instead of making a complex channel on a piece of paper, what we have done is we have printed some channels on both sides of the paper, and then with that printed channel, we have simply heated the piece of paper. So if you heat the piece of paper, the toner particles which come from the printer will melt and block the pores. In this way, the black regions which you see in the slide, these black regions are created. And that is how paper microchannels are made. Simple enough, it doesn't require any device to make channels on a paper. So you just require a printer and a software to design the channel. But could you make it in a more easy way? All of us are familiar with correction pens, the inks, so-called eraser inks, where if you have written something, you can use a whitener and erase it off. So this eraser ink contains titanium dioxide particles, which can create so-called hydrophobic barriers. That means there will be no cross flow, and it can put a barrier of the fluid such that the blood can flow only along a certain direction. So with this, what we have done? We have first done how you separate plasma from the whole blood, because the glucose test that I just showed is based on the plasma of the blood, not the whole blood. So you can do it in different ways. If you go to a elaborate pathological lab, you will find that they are doing it by something called a centrifuge. So instead of putting a centrifuge, what you can do is you make this kind of a design which is there, which you can see in the slide. It is called as a H filter. You know how do you make it? You make it just by origami. The Japanese style of folding something and give it a design or give it a shape. No device is required for manufacturing. So what I am showing is actually machine-free manufacturing. Manufacturing, but it doesn't require any machine. So what there happens is the blood moves and there is a buffer solution which moves along with the blood. And because of the glucose concentration difference, the plasma separates from the whole blood. So when the plasma separates from the whole blood, you can do many tests. I will just give you examples, like you can do blood glucose detection on a printed paper, which I have just demonstrated as a product. But you can see the entire steps here. So what we do is once these tests are done, we validate these tests also with the results that are taken from the pathology lab. So in the pathology, people are collecting a huge volume of blood for their test. We are just taking one drop from that. Doing an analysis using this device, which is actually not a device. It is a piece of paper and a smartphone. That's all is required. What is the principle? That when the glucose it reacts with certain chemicals in presence of certain catalysts, there is a change in color which is proportionate to the volume of the or concentration of the glucose or any other analyte. So we take the image of this colored location. That is what the smartphone camera is doing. And then that image is analyzed. The Android-based platform can do it. And then this is converted into, the intensity is converted into milligram per deciliter blood glucose concentration. In this way, by looking into the intensity of the pixel, we can say that what is the concentration of glucose. So similar thing you can do for hemoglobin. And hemoglobin is a very challenging problem, because if you go to rural scenarios, you will see there are lots of people who need urgent attention because of malnutrition or several other factors. It is very important for pregnant mothers, young children, and so on. So we have made a very simple low-cost device, which is again a paper strip for on-spot detection of the level of hemoglobin. I can go on talking about examples, but because of limited time, I will talk about one or two more. Evaluating antibiotic resistance. This is a very challenging problem, not just in India, but all around the world. There are reasons because of which antibiotics do not work, even when they are administered for a given disease. The reason is that either the same patient had an overuse or abuse of antibiotic earlier. The second reason could be that earlier that patient did not complete a course of antibiotic. Or a third reason could be that the bacteria themselves have evolved to beat the antibiotic. So the antibiotic given to the patient may not work. So what you will do? So we have developed a simple device where there is a color and there is a bacterial sample which is reacting with an antibiotic. So we administer the antibiotic to the bacterial sample. If the bacteria are killed because of the antibiotic, there will be a change of the colored sample from blue to pink. If it is complete pink, then all the bacteria are killed. So according to the colored level, you can give a quantified detection of how much fraction of the bacteria got killed. So very quickly, the doctor can come up with a decision that this medicine, whether it is good for treating a particular bacterial sample or not. Now, I have promised that I will talk about paper, eraser and pencil. So I have talked about how paper and eraser can help in to make a medical device. but here comes pencil. So in a paper device, when you put blood, blood will move by capillary action and it will go to a reaction site where it will react with a chemical to change color. That is the basic principle that we are using. Now, capillary action is rather slow. So instead of capillary action, can you use electric field to move the blood faster? In principle, you can. But making electrodes on a piece of paper is again an expensive proposition. You cannot really use such devices for resource limited settings in the rural population. So instead of making a costly device for electrode fabrication, we did a very simple trick. We made pencil sketch on a piece of paper. The black region that you can see in this slide in the piece of paper is simply a HB pencil sketch. So the graphite which is there in the tip of the lead of the pencil, that acts like electrode. And now if you connect it with copper wires with proper electrical connection, you will see that the blood magically moves very fast by combined capillary action and electric field. That is how our research group first introduced a new subject altogether, paper and pencil microfluidics. So with this paper and pencil device, we have patented a technology by which you can do multiple tests with a single drop of blood. So you put one drop of blood, with that same drop of blood, you can do large number of tests. You need not do different tests with different blood samples. So here is an example where you study glucose and bilirubin with the same single drop of blood using the paper and pencil device. Now the matter doesn't end there. You require to make a professionally looking device to make these things commercializable. And that is what is engineering all about. So I started my journey as a mechanical engineer. Then I went into medical devices because I got fascinated about that. And then I have come into possible mechanisms of commercializing this. So it becomes a viable technology for business. So what you do eventually is you make a device which we have again developed at IIT Kharagpur with the help of the team of one of my younger colleagues, Professor Sudeep Nath. And this device is known as MET colorimeter, which you see here. So I will tell you, so if you run this movie, this movie is about how do you make hemoglobin detection. So there is a printer, a simple printer that prints spots on a piece of paper. Then there is a reagent which is put on the spot, and then the finger is pricked. So as I told you, I am not going to do this with you, so I am showing it with a movie. So then that piece of paper that is put in a device. So today I showed it in a smartphone. This is a previous version of this where we had a separate device with a light source and camera to take the image. So today I have shown a different device where it's just a smartphone doing the same thing. But this is called as MET colorimeter. So you can see there is a change of color, and there is a Bluetooth signal transceiver which takes the light sensor data in lux. So then, to cut this short, we will stop this here. But then you can take this image and do the image analysis and tell what is the hemoglobin concentration. Finally, you know, these devices, if you want to run this in the rural setting, you require to energize this. To energize this means you require some energy to run this device. So, in the same paper and pencil device, we have developed a power plant. All mechanical engineers learn about a hydroelectric power plant. Water is coming from the dam, and then there is a turbine, the turbine blade rotates and the power is produced. Instead of that, we have a piece of paper, water, salt water flows by capillary action, the water gets evaporated. And when the water gets evaporated, there is more pumping. So, and with that more pumping of the salt water solution, more ionic current and power is produced. So these medical devices can run with this power, and you in principle may not require a separate battery to run these devices. So to summarize, I have described a small journey where I started as a mechanical engineer. I ventured into the domain of medical devices with a simple technology that can be used for the common mass, and we have discussed that how this can be brought to commercialization for the benefit of common people. I acknowledge my collaborators and students who have contributed significantly for this research. You can understand that it's a team effort, so individually one cannot do this. And of course, the funding agencies, starting from the foreign funding agencies like the Royal Academy of Engineering UK, to the Indian government, the Department of Science and Technology, Ministry of Human Resources and Development, and so on, to make all this research happen. Thank you very much.